Here we go, episode number 21. We are coming close to the end of the series on Motivation Monday. And that's because we're making reference to the 10 stages of job search. Okay, so let's take a look at this. All right, I'm going to just zoom into the slide itself. I hope you can see it well on screen.
Wow, 什么来的? Wow. 很多星星啊,头上,这是成为明星啊。
Yes, so at this stage, we will say, yay, this is great, congratulations, you got the offer. Yeah, so you have worked so hard, you have gone through so many stages, and finally, you have landed yourself an offer, and we say congratulations. That's really, really good. So I think most of the friends and family who received the good news that you have received the offer will say, hey, quickly go to LinkedIn and update your profile then that you've gotten the job, that you've gotten the offer. You've just signed it, you've just returned it. So quickly update. What do you think, Mr. Ang?
我会迟疑，我不会马上去 LinkedIn update。 因为我都还没有真正到那个公司，所以我什么都不知道，所以我应该是不会 update 我的 LinkedIn.
Oh, okay. I thought I heard you say, yes, you will update. So what you're telling me is, no, you won't update. You won't update. Not so soon. Okay. 是。 So not so soon. Okay, cool. Yeah, it's similar to what I remember, you know, the adage, it ain't over until the fat lady sings. So basically, you know, the soprano singers are typically ladies who are a little well endowed, and they have, you know, they have the capacity of belting out a very, very long song. And it takes, you know, in those days before the entire performance is over, there's this concluding part where the fat lady will come in and give a long rendition that could last actually for about 20 minutes, Mr. Ang, that's very long. You know, 20 minutes. Anyway, okay, jokes aside, what can go wrong? So you have accepted the letter of offer, or you have not accepted the letter of offer, whatever it is, what can go wrong, all right? Because either you have given a verbal agreement or you have given a written agreement, you have given an agreement. Okay, you've given an agreement. What can go wrong? So let's say you have actually decided that, okay, this is great. I've worked so hard. I got the answer. One of the possible things which we are all aware of is during COVID, all of a sudden COVID hits. And when it hits, many things can happen. Many things can happen on your side and also on the employer side. But there's also a possibility that the employer's first choice candidate has come back, changed his or her mind, and wanted to take the job. Oh no, what happened then? Is it legally possible? I'll say, well, it's not because you have actually signed the letter of offer already. But are there going to be some maneuvering in the background? You don't know what you don't know, but there is some. Right now, it's really disturbing, okay? Mm. And of course, it is a threat. The third possibility could be, well, there's something in social media that they've read. Maybe you made some frivolous comment, you know, without thinking. And you made a name for yourself in a negative way. And they've decided, hey, maybe we should pull back a little bit, all right? Another possibility is you've got an internal gatekeeper, which means to say someone who is not on your side, maybe someone who has worked with you before, has, you know, got some additional information about you, and your hiring manager or the HR team, there's someone in there, you know, has got very, what we call, light ear. You listen to everything that comes your way, and then they believe everything that they listen, and therefore maybe they are reconsidering the offer that you have signed. third one could be, well, you might be surprised. I put that an example like a credit card bills, because it could be that at the end of the reference or background check, you didn't come off okay in terms of what you owe. Hey, believe you me, if they want to dig, they can dig anything and everything. And what I'm sharing here is actually a real case that we dealt with, that this individual has got phenomenal bills. And does it really matter? I'll say it matters if the client that you have to deal with is from the banking sector. And so we had an issue because, you know, that particular position requires you to deal with clients from that category. And it doesn't help when you've, as a consumer, you've got a name there, reputation there. Okay, well, I mean, a lot of things can go wrong. That's what I'm trying to say here. It could be weak reference. It could be you've got a non-compete clause where previously it was already clear that it should be okay. And then now you got news from your legal counsel that it's not. That it's not okay, that you need to take extra precaution. So another possibility, as I said, COVID, your budget has changed. And because your budget has changed, they no longer can afford the amount that you asked for, and they might have to shave a little just to maintain the position. And that means it is subject to renegotiation. They may have to open the books again. There are just so many cases out there that I've heard where clients have resigned. What's worse is clients have actually made plans to uproot and go to another location, and then only to find out that the position doesn't exist anymore. Then what happens, right? Another one could be business change. Well, similar to COVID and all that, it could be that, hey, you know, the company no longer needs this position because the purpose of this position is to, let's say, explore the Indonesian market. But you know, due to restriction in travel, you can't travel there, and we don't need anybody there anymore. You don't know what you don't know, but there are external factors that could affect. And that means it could also impact, you know, and have an impact on the reorganization within the within the company that you intend to join. Oh, better still, hiring manager vacates or exited, because maybe, you know, just to maintain the headcount, just to ensure that it's viable, that position doesn't exist anymore. And then the hiring manager has left, whether asked to leave or left on his own accord, or, you know, he's got a better offer. We don't know. And that actually reminds me of a real case that happened to my customer. So here's the thing, right? So my client got the offer and was due to start. He's pretty happy with the offer that he got, but only to find out that, you know, the boss who offered the job, who offered him the job, who interviewed him and offered him the job and even fought for his salary, actually he left. He left, all right? So that boss actually no longer exists because that boss, like, you know, exited. He didn't even know that the boss exited. This, we're talking about him, he has not even started his first day of work, all right? Now, then when he called HR, he discovered, because HR say, oh, you know, the boss that who hired you is no longer with us. So don't worry, we're hiring someone in his place. And so he said, okay, cool. So he kept in touch with HR. And then he called HR at a later point in time also to see, has the new boss joined? So this time around, HR say, yep, new boss, they've decided on who, new boss is coming on board. And then he said, you know, can I meet with the new boss when the new boss comes in? So HR say, okay, well, let's see. I'm not sure if the new boss is open to that, but we'll check with him when he first come on. So finally, he came on. And he called again. And this time round, the new boss did, you know, offer a meeting to meet up with my client. And then what happened was at the end of it, they actually rescinded the offer. Oh my God. Yeah. Wow.
So, 我想到一个一句成语叫做患得患失， 也刚好这句成语也可以提醒那些人刚才你的那个例子。 好，我来讲这个故事吧。
OK。
好，患得患失，这个也是孔子说的，哦，孔子说很多很有意思的话。患得患失，就是你有时你对一个你自己啊，对事情斤斤计较，就是你一定要一直要去找到它的原因，但是你就有时一下子觉得。 哇，好像很好，一下子又好像觉得不好，所以我现在讲这个故事给你听。好吧。从前有一个人叫做后羿，他射箭，他是很会射箭的。他在平常的时候，在练习的时候，百发百中。你看他射的全部都是中间的红点。刚好有一个国王叫做夏王经过，他看到。 哇，这个人好厉害，好厉害！我想请他，他很想请这个人，因为他的射箭很厉害嘛。他就请他到他的皇宫里，所以他到了他的皇宫，他就说，他说为了要增加一些趣味哈，他就跟后羿说，你如果你射不中的话，我就要拿掉你的痦子。
哇，他是，incredible，what a threat！对，因为他讲这样，你这样的玩法才有意义嘛，哈。所以这个后羿听了，I get you now. I get it now. They are increasing the pressure, right?
对了，对了。啊，对。那么这个后羿呢，平常练习的时候是没有问题的，他都是很稳的啊。 当有一样东西进来的时候，他就开始紧张了，就好像刚才你说的嘛，有新的东西进来，他就开始紧张了，他就不能够集中，他就一直想要怎么样射得好，要怎么样射得好，要怎么样，就是一直脑筋一直在想，哦，要怎么样怎么样做得好，不然的话我又怎么样，哦，我会怎么样，哦，所以他就是因为夏王的讲的这样的一句话。 他将整个环境改变了，所以后羿就很紧张了，就一直想着我一定要射好，一定要射好。他想着一定要射好，他那个弓啊就多得很久嘛。一久的话，你射当然是射不到的，所以他真的是射不到了。所以呢，这个故事呢，就是告诉我们做事情有另外一个。 事件来影响你的时候，你要保持镇定，不要患得患失，就好像你的例子一样啦，就是这样。Oh.
Absolutely. Well, my philosophy is keep life simple. Yeah, life is complicated enough. You know, keep it simple. Keep the decision simple. And I like that example. I like that example. You know, if you keep it simple, all things being equal, based on your average performance, you should get it, right? You should get it. But you add undue pressure on yourself. Well, you know yourself best. Some pressures actually improve your performance, what we call boost your performance, but some pressure actually retards your performance. Just got to be really careful. Well, you know, just now when I was sharing all the different factors, all these different factors are talking about the first cluster possibilities, what can go wrong, which is the factors that point that are triggered on the employer side. So there are so many things that are happening on the employer side, but there's also a second cluster, which is there could also be factors that is happening on the candidate side. Mm. So you have signed the letter of offer, and then what could go wrong? What are the possible factors, Mr. Ang?
如果我签了之后，可能我的好事连连，可能有另外一个 offer 进来呢，是吗？
对了，你太聪明了，太聪明了。Okay, so what can actually happen is this, right? COVID, right? COVID happens, and then all of a sudden, oh no, you know, I can't travel. I plan to be there, but I can't be there. Or rather, you know, many things happen on the home front. It could be your first choice employer come back with an offer. So exactly, Stanley, what you have mentioned is the original company. Perhaps you have been interviewing with two possible employers, and then the first one came back. Yeah. Maybe you have read something on glassdoor.com. You know, you have read on some website some negative reviews, and then now you are a little concerned with the negative reviews and the better offer which you have received from that ideal employer. It could be naysayers, because as you go around sharing this piece of good news with your friends and also maybe from your business contacts, and they say, oh gosh, you got to be really careful because this company, you know, they are laying off people left, right, and center, and you really need to be very careful. I'm not too sure, you know. So are you sure you want to join? That's one possibility. Another one could be, what? Who are you working for? Oh, that one, Dragon Lady, you know, Iron Man, whatever nickname you can think of. You know, you're getting worried, right? Or maybe you heard that your nemesis is actually joining as well. So your fan, you know, open an inverted commas, is gonna be there, and you know you're gonna have a hard time. Another one could be self-doubt because you're thinking, no, I managed to fool them. And then I got the job now. Gosh, how am I gonna do the job? You start doubting yourself. Okay. Or maybe, you know, it's not your ideal choice came back, but somehow a new offer came up. A new offer came up, and then you start to think there is some possibility, or you caught up during a networking session and someone made you an offer. And now you are in a dilemma because you have to decide which one are you going to take. It could be business change, as I mentioned. Yeah. So now, huge dilemma. Are you going to entertain the better offer? What do you think, Mr. Ang? What will you do?
如果你问我哈，我的考虑方法是，那个环境，那个工作的环境对我是很重要的。如果那边的人，我觉得我很舒服，啊，对那个工作环境舒服，钱少一点也不是我会接受的，我会接受的。所以我的想法是，最主要是那个环境还是很重要的，工作环境。但是哦，不是所有的人都是像我这样想的哦。
Of course, yes.
所以我要接下来告诉你一个成语，这个成语呢是叫做"利欲熏天"啊。好，我现在将这个成语给你们看。
Yeah.
好，利欲熏天哦，就是这一个人，他眼前看的只是钱而已，他什么都不看。那么在很久以前哦，在一个 market 啊，就是一个市集，有人卖很多东西的，他有卖吃的啦，也有卖金子。你看中间那个桌子都是卖金的，还有卖玩的，还有卖吃的啊，很多人在那边走动啊。那当时呢，有一个人，他穿得很整齐，他大清早就走进来，啊，就是这个戴 mask 的人哈，啊，他走进来，他一看到金子哦，他就拿了，他就跑掉了。然后呢，旁边的人每个人看到，就在那边叫他听不到，他拿了就跑。那结果他被抓到，然后呢，那个官就问他，这样多人，为什么你拿了金子，在这样多人面前拿了就跑？他说，没有啊，我看不到人啊，我只看到金子而已。 他只看到镜子，他没有看到其他的人、啊、他说没有啊，没有人啊，我只看到镜子，我看到镜子我拿了就跑。
You know, this reminds me of a classmate. You know, once upon a time, my classmate actually took the stapler without asking from my table. And then I said, hey, how can you take that? And she said, oh, I'm just borrowing it. So I said, but you didn't ask. He said, oh, I did ask, but it's in my mind. Oh, gosh, this is so funny. Yeah.
所以现在有一些人只是往前看，为了钱。而像如果他有两个 offer， 他已经签了一个，但是另外一个 offer 钱比较高的话，他就毁掉了第一个，去 join 第二个。啊，这个有些人是这样做的，对不对 ，Eileen？
对对对对，讲的非常对 ，and which is why I need to share. Okay, so I think the logical thing, as we all usually do.Is to compare the offers, right? So I think this is very logical, right? Just write down, you know, and put two offers side by side and make a comparison. I think this is the decent thing that you can do. So here's where I will suggest two steps. Okay, so two steps. Even though it looks like a very simple kind of exercise, but you need to keep in mind two steps. So.The first step is revisit your job criteria, your personal criteria. Guys, if you have not listed down your job criteria, well, your criteria for joining that company or whatever company or the companies that you're looking for, please write it down. Create a list right now. Right. Create a list in terms of what you're looking for as a minimum that you hope to get.When you join the next employer organization, or revisit it. And most likely you're going to write down things like that, right? You might write down, I have a minimum salary. I am looking to have good colleagues. I want a location where it is not too far from home. You know, it takes maybe about at most half an hour to get there. I want to make sure that I've got sufficient time.To pursue my hobbies, maybe have time to see the family. And then I want to make sure that I've got benefits as well, you know, benefits like annual leave and then also allowances for et cetera, et cetera. So then with that criteria, you would then do a comparison. Okay. So then you look at it and then you say, okay,So does employer have this? Does employer does not have this? So this is a very fundamental, basic, no-nonsense way of comparing the two offers so that you can make up your mind. But is that enough? I would say not really, because you need to choose a suitable comparison method. And when we talk about the suitable comparison method, the key question here, I'm going to ask you...Mr. Ang, is this?
Yes.
Does it matter? Will your criteria change, or rather, would the method of comparison change depending on whether you have signed the letter of offer or not? Would it be?
哇，这个是一个很好的问题啊。如果我还没有签的话，我可以考虑其他的公司。然后才做选最好的，但是如果我签的话，我觉得如果你签了，你决定了，我本身是我会比较忠心那个签的，我会继续走下去。这是我的看法。
Oh, yes. I remember your first criteria is you just go with it. You won't even entertain. But let's say you have to entertain, yeah? You have to entertain, yeah. Okay, cool. So I really like this, right? Whether you have, you need to ask yourself the first question. If you have not signed the letter of offer, I would say the criteria that we used just now and the method side by side kind of thing, yes, no, is applicable, all right? You can put what we call apples for apples, orange for orange kind of comparison. Just put two offers side by side and then, you know, have evaluate that. That works. But to me, if you have signed the offer, right, if you have signed and accepted the offer and you've already given your word to the employer organization that you're going to join them and even decided on the date that you're going to join them, then here's where I think the next method might help you. And I call this method the marginal benefits versus marginal cost method. All right. And here's what I mean. So let's say your ideal salary should be, you know, let's say you're looking for $5,000 as your ideal salary and you have been asking for $5,000, but guess what? What you settled with this employer was $4,600. Let's say you've settled with $4,600. And so here comes your ideal company and they have actually offered you $5,000. Ooh, bingo, this is great. You know, but they took a while to come back and you have already signed the letter of offer. You have accepted it. So the difference, how much would this be? How much are we talking about? We are talking about $400. We are saying here, you need to compare the two deals because you have already accepted. And here you have to ask yourself, $400, right, is the benefit. If you were to kind of retract, and then join the other organization, $400 is the marginal benefits. Now, there's going to be comparison. You need to compare now, and you need to ask yourself, employer A gives me 20 days of annual leave. Employer B gives me 22 days of annual leave. Voila, no brainer. We should actually go with employer B. But then here in this method, we're talking about only two extra days of annual leave. So it's no longer 22, it's two, okay? It's no longer $5,000, but $400. So then you start calling up additional benefit. I'm talking about employer A is a much reputable organization compared to, you know, employer B, whatever. You do your comparison. But you need to measure the extra bit of company reputation, right? The employer brand. Now, it's going to be really tough, but because it's all relative to you, how you perceive the employer organization, determine the difference, and then also determine the difference in the added knowledge that you're going to gain in that role, whatever it is. You know, maybe you say, oh, by doing this role, I'm going to gain so much knowledge because it's a hands-on knowledge, hands-on experience, you know, real-time business knowledge is going to be so relevant. Anyway, you pile it on, you have a lot of benefits, and now you have to start comparing against, weigh that off, you're going to trade off with the cost. And herein lies the cost, your reputation, your career brand, your reputation. It's what Stanley, you talk about integrity, right? Yeah. Yes. So is your reputation worth more than $400? Is your reputation worth more than the two extra annual leave? You have to ask yourself that. Only you know yourself. I know the answer. The answer will be, oh, no. My reputation is way, you know, worth way more than that. I like to think so. Oh, dear. Yeah, if you're not thinking that, then let's reassure you, you should be thinking that, all right? and then there's also other costs, hidden costs, like total time to hire. Just imagine you went through the entire, all the hoops, right? You passed through all the hoops, the challenges. It's time on your side now, no doubt, but it's also time on the other side. And can you imagine so many parties are involved, yeah, to bring you on board. And guess what? There's also maybe, depending on how the recruiter's contract has been crafted with the employer, there could be a penalty as well. You know, there could be a penalty that a candidate has signed, because I don't know at which point of time. Maybe you're starting like 3 days later and then all of a sudden, you know, you went for a networking lunch and someone made an incredible offer to you, you know. who knows, right? That's usually a penalty to the recruiter. The penalty could be a free replacement and stuff like that. It could be. But if you don't already know, for those of you who land a job through a recruiter, there's a minimum stay period, which could be 6 months. You know, could be some might agree on 3 months. Most employers will insist on 6 months that a candidate should be staying in a job. So minimum stay in any job through recruiters is 6 months. At least that's the least you can do to reward your recruiter. Because if you leave anything earlier than that, they get nothing. Mm. Plus, they have to fund the next replacement hire. All right, but then you might say, why is this piled on me? Well, it is piled on you because the recruiter is not going to work with you anymore. Recruiter is going to say, I'm not going to represent this candidate anymore. That's also an opportunity cost to the hiring organization, because you are a A-lister, or maybe you are a B-lister and they had an A-lister in mind, all right? Or you are the A-lister and they have a B-lister in mind. But because you as an A-lister meaning to say you are the preferred candidate, yeah? And then, and so you got the job, but that means they have to go back to the second candidate and say that, you know, I'm sorry, you didn't get the job. And that actually explains why some employers do not give answers to the B-lister. You could be a B-lister, but they're just waiting to see whether the A-lister actually comes on board or not. And if the A-lister comes on board, then that's great. We can safely close your file and say, hey, let's move on with life. And then inform the B-lister that you were not successful. Yep. So what's the whole rule then? The deciding factor would be, we have to make sure that, all right, the marginal benefits have to exceed marginal costs. So you weigh the benefits against the cost. Something's got to give. What is the item that has to give? Make sure it's worth every single penny. All right. So the deciding factor is whether you have signed the. I can't stress enough that as time goes by, as you deepen your interaction, as you increase your interaction, and as you deepen your connection with the potential hiring organization, there's a lot of factors at play. I know we are talking about more material stuff, but there's also the psychological, mental, and emotional connection that you have with the other party that you need to be a little mindful of. As an organizational psychologist, I will tell you, your psychological contract with the employer outweighs your employment contract. Because if you pay attention to that, if you pay a lot of attention to that, then you will know that, you know, you can build a lot of psychological contract with people. So go forth and build that. Because even if you don't land one job, you know, the psychological contract with your potential hiring manager will be lingering in the potential hiring manager's mind, and they will be thinking, okay, when the opportunity comes, actually I want you on board. And what do I mean by that? You know, integrity is what you say, Mr. Ang. Integrity, your work principles, you know, your work mantra, right? Your moral values, all this does come into play subtly into, you know, throughout your career. And
我非常同意你的想法，因为其实我自己也有这样的经验，什么经验呢？我以前有过要请一个人，最后他请了之后，最后他跑到别的地方去啊，就照你所讲的，但是世界很小啊，因为我们都是在charity organization， 我们都有 seminar 嘛，所以。 我碰到另外一间 company， 他跟我讲，他请了这一个人哦，这样我就跟他讲，哦，他本来在我这边的，他跑到你那边去啊，哦，他就啊是吗？你看他这样的话，无形中对那个人的名誉会，那个人的老板会有不同的想法，对不对？哦，
对，这是我要分享的，Yes, yes. So exit on a good note, you know, enter on a good note as well, which is what we will cover when we say enter on a good note, you know, to your future organization, all right? So we will cover that in episode 22, talking about forgetting about entertaining distraction. You have made up your mind, you have accepted the offer. Now get yourself ready, because there's a lot to do as well, which is what we're going to be covering on the next episode. Okay, well, we are nearly there, almost finishing already. I hope you found today's episode useful. For some of you, this could be a very timely episode for you, because some of you could be also really, really contemplating whether to proceed or to entertain. I hope that gives you enough ammunition to, you know, make an informed decision. So, Mr. Ang, any advice for our listeners?
好，今天啊，我是最主要的是希望大家不要有患得患失的心理。最主要的是你要自己考量自己哪一个是最重要的，坚定那个，千万不要以金钱来衡量，因为金钱在来衡量的话，你很多东西可能就会偏上一边了啊，就是我的建议。
Okay, good. Thank you. So I hope you have enjoyed it as much as we have in sharing this episode to you. So I'm Eileen.
I'm Stanley.
And you have been watching Motivation Monday.
东谈西说.
Okay, one more episode to go. Okay, so guys, have a great week ahead. I know this week, I hope you start your week strong and that you are going to go through your week with lots and lots of excitement. And I wish you good news, good progress, and happy job search. See you then, guys. Bye.
再见啦.